Welcome, my friends. In today's video, we will be determining what is the fastest CPU in the world for gaming. And long story short, it's this one, the Ryzen 7 9800X3D that launches tomorrow. I'm going to be reviewing it today. It was about 10% faster at 1080 gaming than the 7800X3D that it is succeeding. So that's a wrap. We can call it there. This is a pretty short one. Thank you very much for watching. You guys want more detail, some actual benchmark numbers, graphs, that sort of thing? Okay, we can do that too.
Excellent.
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair 3500X mid-tower computer case, featuring an elegant wraparound glass view with removable front and side panels, providing access to a spacious interior that supports up to EATX motherboards. It's also compatible with ASUS and MSI reverse connection motherboards for a clean build, includes convenient cable routing features, and accommodates up to 10 120mm fans with 360mm radiator support at the top and side. For more on the Corsair 3500X, click the sponsor link in the video description. So what I have for you guys today is a pretty straightforward review of the 9800X3D. I ran 15 tests with a pretty even split between gaming and compute performance, but I of course have a few notes to go over before we dive into those numbers. This is expected to be the last major launch of either a CPU or a GPU this cycle, so we're not gonna see anything new until 2025, but the CPU landscape has been a bit tumultuous in 2024 thus far, and that's mostly because of Intel. I extensively covered the instability issues they had with 14th gen processors over the summer and into the fall, and it would seem that Intel has put that snafu behind them. 14th gen processors now have updated UEFIs that have promised to do away with the instability issues of the past, although they have dialed back on performance just a little bit. And in a similar vein, AMD was dealing with some questions as to their peak performance for their Ryzen 7000 and 9000 series processors. And actually going back to their 5000 series processors and before, those issues have now been patched via Windows updates, so we now should be seeing the maximum performance that these CPUs have available. And then the last thing to note would be a bit more related to me, which is that I have not been operating at maximum capacity in the past few weeks, so I took all the time I had available to dedicate to testing for this video, and I ended up with a 4 CPU race. The 7800X3D, the existing champ for best CPU for gaming, the 9800X3D, of course, and then on the Intel side, we have the 14900K, which remains their best CPU for gaming, as well as the newly launched Core Ultra 9 285K that came out just a couple weeks ago, which you would have thought would have been Intel's new best CPU for gaming, but it still lags behind the 14900K in quite a few tests. Here's a look at the specs for all four of these CPUs side by side, and I want to specifically point out that the 7800X3D and 9800X3D are 8-core, 16-thread CPUs that are very specifically focused on gaming, whereas the Intel CPUs I have are 32 threads with the 14900K and 24 threads with the 285K. This is definitely going to give them an advantage and a leg up when it comes to the compute tests. Speaking of test beds, since I missed Intel's launch a couple weeks ago, I needed to set up a new LGA 1851 test bed, and I used the only Z890 motherboard that I currently have on hand, which was sent over by Gigabyte. This is the Z890 Aorus Elite Wi-Fi, and they actually added in this Manta memory kit, which is a 48 gig kit. This is a new line of memory by vColor, and it's got XMP settings for 8600 and 8800 speed, and that is one of the things the new Intel platform can do quite well, is run memory at higher speeds, which can give an advantage in some situations. However, I also received another package from G-Skill, and that had this kit in it, their Trident Z5 CK. These are CU DIMMs, or clock unbuffered memory. This kit's rated for DDR5 8200 speed. Intel says the sweet spot for this platform is about DDR5 8000 or 8200. And since this platform has already been out for a couple weeks and there are existing reviews on it, I decided to throw this really fast memory kit at it to see if it could help make up the performance gap between it and the 7800X3D that already exists, to say nothing of keeping up with the 9800X3D. But I also received a care package from AMD, and the most important thing in there, of course, was the 9800X3D CPU that they wanted me to test, but they were very thorough this time around. They sent not just the CPU, but they also sent an X870E motherboard, the ROG Hero, as well as this Trident Z5 Neo RGB memory kit, as well as an SSD with the proper version of Windows pre-installed onto it. They even put a Windows key on the back, so I guess that was somewhat thoughtful. But I'm a contrary person, and when I feel like I'm receiving this level of handholding, part of me says, no, I don't want to do it that way. So I opted to update my X670E motherboard, which is also an ASUS ROG Hero. ASUS had already posted a BIOS update for that board, which has a GISA, I think 1.2.02A, which is the one we're supposed to be using for this testing. I made that choice for a few reasons. One is because a lot of people might be considering an upgrade to the 9800X3D from an existing like X670 or X670E motherboard. And you should know that you can get the same amount of performance out of the existing 670 6600 series motherboards, you don't need to buy an X870 or X870E motherboard. And also just to maintain consistency between testing by using the same platform for both the 7800X3D and the 9800X3D. My final thing to point out is that even though I went with that X670E motherboard that I've been using for quite a few benchmark runs so far, the most recent ASUS UEFI update for it had things running slightly out of spec. The FCLK, or Infinity Fabric clock, was running at 2100 megahertz instead of the AMD recommended 2000 megahertz. I did go into the UEFI and manually set the FCLK to 2000 megahertz so it would be more in line with the AMD's recommended out of the box configuration. With all that said, let's get into my actual test results. We'll start things out with a stress test. That is IDA 64, running this for 10 plus minutes, ended up going about 15. My 9800X3D regularly hit 5,225 megahertz or 5.225 gigahertz during my testing, but under this full load stress test situation, it dialed back the clock speeds a bit to moderate temperatures. And it did a pretty good job of that, keeping the temps in the high 60s and staying about a degree cooler than the 7800X3D in the same test with the same Corsair 360mm all-in-one liquid cooler. During this test, the average frequency across all cores was about 4.9 gigahertz, 4.89 or so, still peaking at 5.225 gigahertz on occasion. I couldn't help but notice that some of the compute tests that I ran pushed these temperatures higher to the mid to upper 80s Celsius when all cores were at 5.225 gigahertz under load and the CPU wasn't throttling. The hottest of these tests was CPU Mark, which caused the 9800X3D to peak in the 92 to 94 degrees Celsius range during the SSE compression and encryption tests. But during the rest of my compute tests, we didn't get over 90 degrees Celsius. And while gaming temps are not really much of a concern, it peaked in the mid 60s to mid 70s. The max was 77 during gaming. Let's look at power draw numbers next, where the 9800X3D pushes past the 7800X3D in terms of power draw by a pretty decent amount. 60 to 80 watts more total system power usage during typical use, although both Ryzen CPUs pale in comparison to the 14900K. The 285K is more efficient versus Intel's last Gen 2, and thanks to the 9800X3D getting just a bit lax in terms of efficiency, in my humble opinion, in order for AMD to deliver more performance, these two CPUs are closer on these charts than you might expect. Moving on to the benchmarks proper though, starting with compute, aka raw CPU performance, starting with Cinebench R23 multi-thread, and please note that where possible, I've supplemented these charts with my legacy data to provide a broader frame of reference. Here's Cinebench R23 single-thread performance next. So alongside the results for the four main CPUs I tested, I have numbers from reviews that I've done in the past few months. Just please note that those results don't include more recent updates to Windows, CPU microcode adjustments, etc., and they won't be included in the summary comparison at the end. Here's Cinebench 2024 next. It's scored differently, but like you saw with R23, the higher core count CPUs fare much better in the multi-threaded tests. The 285K is looking good here, even against AMD's 16 cores. In the single thread test, the 285K comes out with the win again, and this is often a good indicator that a CPU will game well too, but we already know that that's not the case with the 285K. Not that it can't game, it just, well, we'll get to that. Here's Passmark 11's CPU Mark. This is the test that ran hot for the 9800X3D, though it still gets a nice improvement over the 7800X3D and the 9700X in the multi-threaded test. In single thread, we have another win for the 285K, although it's an empty victory in my opinion if it doesn't help along towards better gaming numbers. The 9800X3D showed a nice 17% boost over the 7800X3D. Blender 4.2.0 is next, which is a free and open source 3D creation suite. The OpenData 3.1 test provides a samples per minute score across three test scenes, Monster, Junk Shop, and Classroom. The 285K showed a nice improvement over the 14900K, but still didn't pass the 9950X, while the 9800X3D was 29.8% faster than the 7800X3D. Next, we have video transcoding via Handbrake, processing a 150 megabit H.264 4K video down to 1080p with the fast preset. The encoding speed is shown as a frame rate, and the 285K was the clear winner, beating the 14900K by more than 10 seconds. Here's Corona 10. The Corona renderer is available standalone or as a plugin for 3D Studio Max or Cinema 4D. We're looking at rays per second, so higher is better. It's another test where the 285K shows a big boost over the 14900K. 9900K, but still can't catch the 9950X. Rounding out our compute tests, we have 7-zip testing basic file compression and decompression. In the compression test, the 285K edges out the 14900K, while the 9800X3D is up about 13% over the 7800X3D. In decompression, the 16-core Ryzen chips dominate, while the 9800X3D was up about 10% over its predecessor. Moving on to gaming benchmarks, where I've tested all the games at 1080p, except 3DMark, and again, our GPU is NVIDIA's RTX 4090 Founders Edition. This is 3DMark times by Extreme, a synthetic DirectX 12 benchmark from 3DMark, where the RTX 4090's graphics score doesn't fluctuate much from CPU to CPU. So we focus on the CPU test, where the 285K dominated with a score of 13,983. Please note that the 3DMark results are not included in my cumulative gaming performance numbers. The rest of these games are, though, starting with Shadow of the Tomb Raider. We're testing at 1080p because it's a resolution people actually game at, and it's more CPU dependent than 1440 or 4K. Get ready for a rout, though. The 9800X3D is 13.4% faster than the 7800X3D here. In Cyberpunk 2077 Phantom Liberty, the 9800X3D is 13.8% ahead of the 7800X3D. And then we have Total War Warhammer 3, where the 9800X3D wins its narrowest victory, just 0.6% faster than the 7800X3D, barely keeping that streak alive. Next is F1 23, and yep, the 9800X3D is 3% ahead of the 7800X3D here. Horizon Zero Dawn Remastered is my newest game, asterisk, where the 9800X3D was 11.4% faster than last gen. I'm not even really mentioning the Intel CPUs because it's a bit embarrassing at this point, but continuing on to Starfield, where the 14900K and 285K do manage to stay ahead of the 7800X3D, but the 9800X3D takes yet another W at 155.3 FPS. And my final title is Microsoft Flight Simulator, because so many of you all request it, and somehow the 9800X3D squeezes 95 FPS out of the 4090 without the aid of FrameGen, 16.4% faster than the 7800X3D. And yes, this is also one of several titles where, I have to mention it, the 5800X3D, an AM4 CPU, still beats the 285K. All right, that was a lot of data to get through, but now let's simplify and summarize things with these conclusion graphs. I'm using the 7800X3D as the 100% baseline here, and again, do note that we're comparing 8-core 16-thread AMD CPUs to Intel CPUs with higher core and thread counts. AMD has more competitive CPUs for these types of tests, with like the 9950X3D, which was included in some of the earlier graphs. But let's give Intel credit where credit is due. The 285K was the winner in this particular set of tests, going up to 208% of the 7800X3D's performance. That's up from 187% that the 14900K achieved, and the 285K did it while running cooler and using less power. And while I wanted to include those compute tests in this review, the real focus for the 9800X3D is gaming. So looking at that comparison, we can see a 10% boost, actually 10.2% increased performance versus the 7800X3D for the 9800X3D. And as expected, since this was established a couple weeks ago when the 285K reviews first came out, it cannot even keep up with the 14900K when it comes to gaming, coming at 88.5% of the 7800X3D's performance. And here on this last slide, I'm just adding the prices as well, so you can compare those. Although I will say that the 9800X3D's price, while it's promised to be $480 MSRP, there's still a big question when it comes to availability, how quickly these are gonna get scooped up, or if there's gonna be any price increases as we've recently seen with the 7800X3D. All right, it's conclusion time. Let's talk pros and cons. The 9800X3D is definitely the fastest CPU currently available for gaming. That seems pretty undisputed at this point. It is also more efficient, drawing less power and not reaching as high of temperatures as either Intel's 14th or 15th gen processors, as we sometimes call the Core Ultra 200 series. And finally, it costs less money. It's cheaper than the 285K for sure. And while we would like to see prices dip down below that $400 mark, I definitely remember when the 7800X3D was going for $330 to $350 pretty easily. In the current market, the two best CPUs for gaming, the 9800X3D and 7800X3D, seem like they're probably gonna stay above $400 and even closer to $500 for the time being. But how about cons? Do I have anything negative to say about the 9800X3D? I thought it was interesting, and this isn't like a really harsh negative, but I thought it was interesting that while Intel this generation had to dial back on power usage to try to get their temperatures under control, AMD had the opportunity to say, we've got some thermal headroom, and I think that's what they went for with the 9800X3D. By taking advantage of the fact that they flipped the 3D V-Cache and put it on the bottom, they were able to get better thermal performance, but I think they still pushed the clock speeds to a point where the 9800X3D is running warmer than the 7800X3D or many of the 7000 or recent 9000 series CPUs that have come out. But it's really a soft con because for the majority of tests, temperatures did stay below 90 degrees, and for gaming, it was typically more in the 65 to 75C range. And the only other real complaint would be if you're looking at the compute performance, Intel definitely had the advantage with the set of tests that I ran. But again, I didn't have time to retest the 9950X3D, and that's really what AMD is putting up as a competition if you're looking at really heavy compute needs. Also, AMD has the 9950X3D and 9900X3D waiting in the wings that should be 12 core and 16 core variants of this CPU. And those are supposed to have 3D V-Cache on both CCDs, which should hopefully help in some of the situations that have held back the 7950X3D and 7900X3D with core-to-core latency. But that is going to wrap it up for my review of the 9800X3D. Definitely a CPU that I would recommend to anyone who's looking to build the fastest gaming PC that they can possibly build right now. The big question is going to be, let's keep an eye on stock availability and pricing, and I'll follow up a little bit on that when I come back with tech news on Sunday. So if you guys haven't already subscribed to my channel, consider doing that so you can be notified when my new videos go up. And if you'd like to help support the channel, consider checking out my store, PaulsHardware.net, where you can buy shirts, mugs, pint glasses, and all manner of high quality Pauls Hardware paraphernalia, including my new mouse mats, which are super awesome. I'll post links to the CPUs as they go live down in the video's description below. Thanks again for watching. Hit the thumbs up button on your way out if you enjoyed it, and we'll see you all in the next video.